Good afternoon, everyone. Just want to thank you for being here. This is such an August gathering. My father is watching over us. I think he knows every one of you is who's sitting here and enjoying your presence. To us, as all fathers are, I guess, to their children, he was a very, very special man who touched lots and lots of lives in the most beautiful of ways, and I think that's his gift to all of us. When I think of him, I think of him as a community builder, a musician, someone always on the search for the unusual, someone who knew how to love people and bring people together. And, you know, we just hope, Broto and I, that we can do him justice by living the life he taught us. But again, thank you so much for coming. And it's my great pleasure also to introduce Kamanashish Chakraborty, who will be introducing all the various parts of the program today. Kamanashish and my dad have been friends for more than 40 years, and we're really privileged to have you and all his other friends who've agreed to speak. I mean, Baba passed away on the 22nd at night, and we thought, wow, you know, the 29th of December is his birthday. We should try and have the memorial celebration for him today if we could. And starting from the Friends Meeting House being available to every single person we wanted to have speak, making time for us, this is just our privilege that we get to meet and be with all of you. So thank you very much. Roto, do you want to say a few words?
I think she said it all. Baba's been not only a good father, but he was like a friend to me and to everybody, the same attitude towards the family, you know. And so it was just great having him for all these years. There was a lot of happiness. There was a lot of separation. There was a lot of everything. He lived a large life. He had lots of friends and, you know, he had a good time. And, you know, he paid for my tabla lessons ever since I was five. So, Baba, thank you, you know. And, you know, it's just, and we had a little time with him at the end. So it wasn't a shock. It was a good way for him to go. And so, you know, he would spend half the year in India and half the year here. And he would spend time with Chumu mainly, she put him up. But whenever they would fight, he would come and stay with me. And whenever he would fight with both of us, he would go to friends like Shongamitra, thank you, you know? And all of that, so he wasn't limited to just us, he had all of you. And for that, I thank you, because I personally was lazy and let Baba do all the societal work with Sanskriti, with everything. I just concentrated on the music, you know? So it was like I needed time, so I was there. But I went to college as soon as I came to the States, and he wasn't here then. Later on, he came. My mom was here. And so that was a great time. You know, I got to know my mother, and we got to know about loss, you know? But I'm getting used to him not calling me and saying, where the hell are you, you know? And his voice I miss. But all of you are here, and I'll do more, you know? Thank you for coming. Let's celebrate his life, yeah?
Thank you, Broto. Thank you, Krishna. It's my great privilege and honor to welcome you all at the memorial service for our universal Bachuda. Hitabrata Roy, we all know him as Bachuda. The affix Da means elder brother. Elder brother Bachu is so much universal that a child who merely starts to speak would call him Bachuda, and the eldest person in the room would also call him Bachuda. He was that universally known as Bachuda. For our program today, we have a chart to follow, and I'll be introducing our speakers, and we'll have musical interludes. Our vocalists are here. They will perform the songs, the particular songs that they used to perform at Bachuda's home under his leadership on Sunday mornings at potluck brunch. And that was the way of Bachuda building a bond with the community, with the people. Even the members of the group bonded because of those little regular incidents. They will be performing those songs today. And in the end, we will have little free time, depending on how much time we have at hand, for any one of you who wants to share his or her thoughts, memories about Bachuda. That will be in the end. Let's start. Our first speaker is Awilda Marquez, who was Bachuda's student at the State Department's Foreign Service Institute in the 1980s. Awilda worked for 6 years in the U.S. Foreign Service in Dhaka, Bangladesh, and Nairobi, Kenya, and later served as Assistant Secretary of Commerce and Director General of U.S. and Foreign Commerce Commercial Service. She's a graduate of University of Maryland Law School, and she earned a Juris Doctor degree and was an assistant editor of the Law Review. Awilda Marquez, please.
Bachoo and Minotti were a very important part of my life. In 1983, I drew what then I thought was the short straw and was assigned to Bangladesh as my second tour in the Foreign Service. I did not want to go there, but that's what I was told I had to do. And in order to do that, I had to go through language training. Choy mash of language training, 6 months. Choy mash, panch din shaptahe, 5 days a week, 8 hours dine, 8 hours a day. 6 months, 5 days a week, 8 hours a day, I was with Bachoo and Minotti, learning Bangla. Minotti D was the one who taught me the language so well that I was able to arrive in Bangladesh completely fluent in Bengali, spoke it the whole time I was there, and because of that was able to make very important contacts for the United States government, including with Sheikh Hasina and Begum Zia, who are now the two rotating presidents of the country, was very, very productive, and loved it. I loved Bangladesh, I loved the Bengalis, but I also went, we went to Kolkata for R&R, and we went as often as we could to Kolkata, and that Minotti and Bachoo had taught me was the place to go to enjoy Bengali culture, Bengali music, Bengali arts, Bengali everything, which I learned to love. So Minotti taught me the language, but it was Bachuda, who taught me the politics and the culture of Bengali, of Bengal. From the music to the art, everything. He was so in love with his culture and with the singing, and he instilled that in me. And for that, I have always appreciated what he did for me in preparing me to be able to serve my country in the land that he loved so much, Bengal. Knowing the music that he loved so much, which I sought out when I was there because of him. And he enriched my life and enriched my service to my country because of his love for the culture. I'll never forget Minotti and her teaching, Bachuda and his constant nagging and pushing and making sure that I learned everything that needed to be learned, including the arts and culture and song. But then in the end, he always said, Awilda, top jache, top jache. I'm going to the top. And now I think now I say Bachuda, top eshache, So let us all celebrate Bachoo. I celebrate him, strong memories, and I wish that you all have the same kind of wonderful memories, enrichment that he brought to our lives and he brought to my life. Thank you.
Thank you.
speaker is Sigmund Cohen. Mr. Cohen has known the Roy family, Bachuda, for nearly 5 decades, I guess. He first met Bachuda and Minoti Roy in 1966, I believe. And then on, Mr. Cohen has gone on to his career with the Foreign Service. He served in Dhaka, Bangladesh, in the Indian city of Calcutta, which is now known as Kolkata, and as well as in Germany and in Britain. He also served as the Director of Public Affairs in the former Arms Control and Disarmament Agency and Director of Programs for the Television Service of what was then called USIA, the United States Information Agency. Mr. Cohen, sir.
I mean, I'm a Bangla Bhasha Puligachi, but I mean, Ajte Hushi Je Ami Echene, with all of you. In my work as an elder mediator, I often ask parties to a dispute, how do you want to be remembered? This is the legacy question. Namely, this query is bound to get people thinking about how they want to be recalled by their children, by their loved ones, their friends, and acquaintances. In Bachoo's case, there is no question how I will remember him and his legacy. One, as an inspiration. If there's anyone who made his life a testament to vitality, inquiry, and action, it was Bachoo. Never have Susan, my wife, nor I met anyone with a zest for life that Bachoo manifested. I remember our last meeting with him a few weeks ago. When we arrived, he was sleeping, but within moments he awoke and began to describe, with his typical vigor and enthusiasm, his forthcoming memoir. Among other things, we marveled at his elegant Bengali script, handwritten script. Two, as a sage. For many of us working in Kolkata, either for the US government or for other organizations, Bachoo was without a doubt the sage of Calcutta. We arrived there in 1966 to work with the US Information Service. In a matter of days, I learned that the number one go-to guy for information on most anything in Bengali, in Bengal, or in India for that matter, was Bachoo. There's no doubt that he provided invaluable and objective counsel to numerous State Department officials, if not to every Foreign Service officer who served in Calcutta during his time with the Consulate General. We all owe Bachoo a profound debt of gratitude. He never minced words and always spoke with insight and precision. In a sense, Bachoo was truly a gift, not just to the United States, but to India as well. Three, as a Renaissance man. How many of us have Bachoo's depth of knowledge and understanding, not just about politics, but about art, culture, and philosophy? Bachoo's curiosity, his energy, depth, and his style distinguished him. I can truly say I have rarely met anyone who could so knowledgeably discuss any of these subjects with such clarity and comprehension. I'll close with this apt quote from Bachoo's and many of yours favorite poet, Rabindranath Tagore. Death is not extinguishing the light, it is only putting out the lamp because the dawn has come. Dhanyavaad.
Thank you, Mr. Cohen. I would now request Maryland Congressman Honorable Chris Van Hollen, who is with us today. His acquaintances with Bachuda and the Roy family goes back years. I believe Congressman's father was Bachuda's superior officer in Kolkata. Is that right, sir?
Well, nobody could be a superior officer to Bachoo. In terms of knowledge and depth of knowledge of India. Listen, I, To Krishna and Broto, thank you for bringing us together to remember your wonderful father. And it's a privilege for my sister Caroline and I to be here to celebrate his life. Because the Roy family has been a long-lasting family of friendship with the Van Hollen family. And as you indicated, my father and mother arrived in Calcutta in the mid-1950s, just the same time that Bachoo was beginning work as the chief political specialist at the consulate in Calcutta. Our father was the American political officer in Calcutta, having just come from New Delhi, which was my father and mother's first overseas post. And my father and mother, as we were growing up and talking about different issues of foreign policy around the dinner table, would always reference Bachoo Roy and the knowledge that he brought to the issues in Calcutta, in India, and throughout South Asia. We also have in our house, as my sister Caroline reminded me, a number of pieces of wonderful artwork from their time in Calcutta, which was a time with the ending of British colonial rule where you saw a flowering of artists in the area. And I think it must have been Bachoo who pointed out a couple of pieces from what were then obscure artists who since became very well known. And if you come to our visit our house, you'll find lots of artwork that I think Bachoo Roy would probably point out to my parents. From Calcutta, my father and mother went to a number of other posts, including Karachi, Pakistan, where I was born, to Turkey, and then Sri Lanka, mostly South Asia. And throughout that period of time, kept in very close touch with Bachoo Roy. And certainly, his insights into what was happening in the region were always treasured by my father, regardless of what post he was at. He also served our father as the Deputy Assistant Secretary of State for Near East and South Asia during that very turbulent time in the 1971 period of time when Bangladesh became an independent country. And there were lots of tensions within the U.S. government at that time. My father took a very different view of the time from Henry Kissinger and has, you know, I think Bachoo and my father very much shared the view of what was happening at that time in the region. Then in 2002, after I served in the Maryland legislature for a period of time, I decided to run for Congress. And my father and mother, of course, reached out to all of their friends throughout the area, including Bachoo. And I can say with a fair amount of confidence that as a result of Bachoo's efforts, I probably got every vote from the Bengali American community, and hopefully most of the votes from the Indian American community. But Bachoo, of course, has a huge network in the Bengali community here in Maryland and throughout the region, in fact, throughout the country. In a number of years after being elected, I remember addressing a Bengali conference that was gathering in Baltimore as a result of Bachoo's work and efforts. So my sister Caroline and I are just, you know, privileged to be here in memory of your wonderful father, who served India so well, who served the United States well in terms of opening up improved understanding between our countries. And the one thing that I had not been aware of, Krishna, is that is your father's connection to the Quaker and Friends movement. That was something I had not known until your decision to bring us together here at the Friends house. And my sister and I were here, and Krishna and some others, in January of this year, because my father was a Quaker, and my father passed away in January of this year. So in many ways, it's fitting and moving from our perspective that Bachoo and my father rejoin
together, and I'm sure they're having a heck of a time looking out over this beautiful gathering where we can remember Bachoo, and my father would, I'm sure, be celebrating probably over a drink or something up there. But as I walked into the Friends Meeting House, of course, remember my father and the relationship that he treasured with Bachoo.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Geraldine Forbes, who recently retired from her position as a distinguished teaching professor of history at the State University of New York and Oswego. And her academic specialties include the history of colonial and modern India, as well as women's history. In 1979, Dr. Forbes was awarded with Rabindra Puraskar, named after our revered poet-philosopher Rabindranath Tagore, for the best book published in published on Bengali culture in 1979. She knew Bachuda for how many years? I don't know. 40, 50, 40. Dr. Forbes, please.
Good afternoon. I'm absolutely delighted to be here. I know that we all remember Bachoo differently. And of course, we have song today. So one of the themes always in Bachoo's life is song for so many of you. But it's many other things as well. So what I actually want to talk about, just one part of him, which I think not everyone knows, and that was his continuing commitment and encouragement for those of us who were teaching in universities and researching and publishing. And I know that Kathy O'Connell is going to talk also more about this. I met Bachoo when he was a political analyst at the American consulate in Calcutta. And I met him because my advisor, who was Blair Kling at the University of Illinois, and someone who had written on the Indigo Mutiny, the Indigo Rebellion in the 19th century, and had written a book on Prince Dwarkanath Tagore, gave me a list of actually four people I should meet in Calcutta, a list of four. So Bachoo was on it. He was one of the people with his colleague Sharman Roy, who were both at the consulate. And these were people who were absolutely must people, must see, the go-to people, the people who were going to introduce you to one. We met over 40 years ago and became friends for a very, very long time in a connection that included his family and extended family, and my family and extended family. So it goes on and on in terms of places we met, which would be, you know, in upstate New York or in Washington or in Shantiniketan or in Calcutta. So it ranged through these different places. So I'm going to say just a bit about how much he encouraged those of us who were doing research and studying South Asia. I met him, as I told you, because of my advisor, Blair Kling. When I started out, I was doing research on 19th century intellectuals who were studying European philosophies and what came to Calcutta from those exchanges. And I turned after a couple of years to begin doing research on women, and women in particularly the 1920s and 30s. And Bachoo was delighted. All right. So, as we all know, Bachoo, of course, liked women a lot, and we have women speaking, women in his audience, but he loved the idea that I was going to do research on women's history. And so this opened up the opportunity for him to start telling me remembered stories. So I actually was led to look at some of the women revolutionaries, and Bachoo Da was then telling me about songs he remembered that people would sing of Shanti and Shuniti, the brave teenage revolutionaries, and the stories he had heard of Bina Das, who tried to assassinate the governor. And then he talked about the women who were leaders when he became a student activist and became one of the people demonstrating in the 1940s. So his stories were about how, I mean, they were very alive, very vivid, and actually made me think about all the things that historians find hard to capture, like emotion, the expression on someone's face. He talked about one woman, and he said, oh, and you know how Bachoo talked, you miss his voice, that, you know, she had these big sparkling eyes, and she spoke, and she was so dramatic, and we as students all wanted to follow her. So he remembered the people I was studying, he introduced me to other people, and always, I think more than anything, encouraged me. No idea, no sort of thing you were pursuing was stupid. He always said, go for it. And so I want to just do a very short list of people that I know he influenced. My own advisor, Blair Kling, John Broomfield, who's in Australia, who wrote about elite conflict in plural society, 20th century Bengal. Charles Capwell, who's in Illinois, he's in Chicago now, who wrote about the music of the bowels of Bengal. Lisa Knight, A Contradictory Lives, Bao Women in India and Bangladesh. And Lisa wrote to me and said she remembered not only that Bachoo introduced her to Bao Women, and encouraged her, but also fed her, she thinks, probably 10 different versions of eggplant. Jeannie Openshaw, who wrote Seeking Bowels of Bengal, Sarah Lamb, who wrote White Saris and Sweet Mangoes about aging, gender, and body. Kathleen O'Connell is going to talk about herself. What I most valued about Bachuda was his openness to ideas, and this is what I want, I guess, us to remember. And I'll just end with an anecdote. I was in Shantiniketan, I think in the mid-90s, and he asked me, I was staying at his house, and he said, you can join my whatever, you know, Tuesday morning chat group, right, whatever. They always discuss new ideas and things that interested them. Since I was there, we were going to talk about, you know, research on women's work. And Bachoo was, I think, fresh from conversations with Moni Nag, so he introduced the group to the concept of sex work, which he thought was an absolutely marvelous new concept being introduced. And he talked to his colleagues about how this was going to cause us to rethink some of our conventional ideas about prostitution, about work, and challenge things that we had thought we already understood and knew. So I just wanted to end with that anecdote. I think this was, for me, kind of vintage Bachoo, never, ever saying, I know it all. This is how it is. We're finished with this topic. We've got the last word. I think I saw him in October, and he was still open to new ideas. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
just to think about what Dr. Forbes said, the Tuesday meetings. I remember Jhumu telling me later that it became a tradition. What actually happened was Bachuda and Minoti Roy, they were so social and outgoing all through their lives that people would drop by to visit them and would find the home empty. So but they were, you know, in the early days, telephone connections were not that easy, and people would travel quite a bit of distance and then find Bachuda not at home. So decided to make Tuesday, the evening they will stay home. That became a tradition of Tuesday discussion sessions later on. Our next speaker is Michael Schneider, professor at the Maxwell School of Citizenship and Public Affairs at Syracuse University and director of the university's Washington International Program. In the 1980s, Schneider was deputy associate and acting associate director of USIA, again, as the agency was known then, for policy and programs. He also served as USIA liaison with the National Security Council, and he was senior advisor to the Undersecretary of State in, I believe, in the mid-90s, I'm sorry. He met Bachuda during a posting in Kolkata, and that was like in the 60s, I guess, Mr. Schneider said.
Thank you. It's a pleasure. It's an honor to be here with you, with Brutu and Jhumu and the family. My relationship with Bachu goes back to the spring of 1963. I was newly arrived. Raka, Ruma, and Radha Bhattacharya took me in hand, and they showed me Calcutta. Their friend Mantu had a car, and we drove around. And then within weeks of arriving, I met Bachu. And like Sig, I was a Bangla language officer. In fact, I wrote the course. There was no course. At the time when I was supposed to take the language in at the Foreign Service Institute in Washington, they discovered that the only materials were army manuals from the Second World War, not relevant to the knowledge of someone working in cultural and public affairs. So when I arrived in Kolkata, Hindi Urdu linguist from the embassy in Delhi came down, and I wrote a course, which was wonderful for me to speak in public affairs, and I think Sig benefited from it. Others who came later, I hope they revised and refined the course of study. But the problem was that my language was very chaste. My teachers thought it was best to teach an outsider language that used words like Dishididdaloy and Jono Shadharam. One night at dinner with the Karlekar family, Mrs. Karlekar started teasing me. She said, Jono Shadharam. And so I commiserated with Bachu a little later. And I said, Bachu, what do I do? My teachers are teaching me a very bookish Shakespearean form of the language. And he said, well, why don't you go to Shantiniketan? Which I did. I went to Shantiniketan. I spent a month in the third grade trying to improve my language. Their voices were perfect. Their vocabulary was just about my level. No ambient sounds. And when I came back, I was then ready to go really do more with the language and with the people. My favorite events were Tuesday evenings, that you mentioned, at Bachu's house, for the songs, good food, the camaraderie. It was a home away from home for someone. And then, of course, North Calcutta, the university coffee houses. Every Saturday, Bachu and I would head off to those coffee houses. If you haven't been to Calcutta, or if you haven't been to the coffee houses, you must go. It's different. It's not like a coffee house in the United States. It's not downstairs, small, the barista is pouring you a grand latte. It's huge. It's a huge, cavernous building with balconies, with boys ogling the girls, and with strong madrasi coffee, with all kinds of fried goodies to eat. And the noise, for a non-Bangla speaker, if you can understand the language spoken idiomatically, quickly, with all the noise in a coffee house, you understand the language. I was about halfway there, but you know, fortunately, Bachoo could always prompt me and explain what this word and that phrase was. And he was a joy to be with. He was musical. He was musical. The voice was musical. That deep, Brutu has the same voice, that deep, resonant baritone bass. Opinionated, yes, of course, but always musical. And he taught me so many lessons about people and about life and about politics and about the relationships that have stayed with me all these years. I came back, I wed, I took a different path from the Foreign Service, although I stayed in public affairs. But always, you know, that Tagore phrase, someone can help me about a jabe nafire, a bharatiya deshe, meaning you can take the boy out of India, but you can't take India out of the boy. And that was a lesson from my experience in working and being with Bachoo. Also, on the weekends, we would go out to the villages for service. I think Bachoo actually was the organization, something called the International Voluntary Service, something like that. And we would go out and do, we would build a school or we would build houses brick by brick. And I have some pictures, Brutu and Jumo, I will get those pictures out and I'll make copies for you of stringy, skinny little Jumo and Brutu helping with the bricks in the line. You know, I've got one with Brutu on the top of the wall looking down, handing the brick up. And it was a wonderful experience. It was a total experience if you want one like that, apart from the public life that one such as I was involved in. So, Bachoo, if you're listening to me, thank you very much. I too will quote a little bit of Tagore for you. When the heart is hard and parched up, come upon me with a shower of mercy. When grace is lost from life, come with a burst of song. When tumultuous work raises its din on all sides, shutting me out from beyond, come to me, my Lord of silence, with thy peace and rest. When my beggarly heart sits crouched, shut up in a corner. Break open the door, my king, and come with the ceremony of a king. When desire blinds the mind with delusion and dust, O thou holy one, thou wakeful, come with thy light and thy thunder. Thank you. You have the quiet.
Do you have the quiet? Where have all the flowers gone?
The reason we chose this song was it was one we sang on Tuesday nights.
Uh-huh.
And the story behind Tuesday nights was, this is sort of pre-telephone days and people were tired of coming to the house and not finding us. So my parents made a pledge that they would be home every Tuesday night. And then people started coming and they got bored and then they said, okay, we'll sing. And we began singing songs from all over the world. And I thought, today we sing Where Have All the Flowers Gone, and all of you can join in, because this was a song we sang many, many years ago, many a time.
Sure.
So.
Where
have all the flowers
gone? Oh.
Thank you.
now invite Dr. Kathleen O'Connell. Dr. O'Connell is a lecturer at the University of Toronto. She earned MA in Comparative Literature from Jadavpur University, Kolkata, and a PhD in Indian Cultural History from University of Toronto. Kathy teaches courses on Rabindranath Tagore and Satyajit Ray at New College, University of Toronto. Her publications include Rabindranath Tagore, The Poet as Educator. Dr. O'Connell, please.
Good afternoon. I'm very honored to be here today. I would like to begin by offering my condolences to Jumu and Broto and the Roy family, and to especially acknowledge Jumu for all she has done in the last years to make her father's life livable. As we know, there have been many dress rehearsals for this moment. Health crises and Bachoo would always rebound. And my husband Joseph and I were in Shantiniketan when two of these crises occurred, rushing Bachoo in by ambulance to Kolkata. And also when he was in Toronto, there was another health crisis and he ended up in the hospital, but always he came back. And I know we were all hoping against hope that that's what he would do this time as well, but it was not to be. And so we're here to mourn this remarkable, larger than life figure who so loved life and people and had such an ability to live fully in the present, something I think very few people have. My husband and I first got to know Bachoo in the 70s when Bachoo and Meenati brought Purnadas Paul to Toronto and they stayed at our house for a week. And it turned into a Bengali mela. It was wonderful. Music, conversation, laughter, people coming in, and of course, wonderful food, especially after Meenati and Manju Das took over the kitchen. And we went to the market and had food. And then the friendship deepened over the years, and as we began going regularly to Shantiniketan, Bachoo Da, with his characteristic generosity and hospitality, invited us to make the Rai Bhavari as our base when we were in Shantiniketan. And he designated my husband Joseph as Dada, and I became Bodhi. And those were wonderful times. And I was thinking if I were trying to describe the complex personality of Bachoo Da in a short way, I would call him the master of the art of life. And I think this came out at many levels. There was, of course, the aesthetic, artistic level, and in Shantiniketan it came out so well, the beautiful architecture and decor of the Rai Bhari, which the personal paintings and the arrangement of the furniture, and the garden. Bachoo loved nature. He was always going to the garden center to just get the right type of flower and make sure the color palette was just right in the beautiful garden and the sculptures of Shankar Ghosh in front. And it, of course, also came out in his musicality, which permeated everything Bachoo did. There was wonderful music, cosmopolitan, has been mentioned, from folk songs to classical. And many evenings of Bachoo playing the organ and Bulbul Basu singing Rabindra Sangeet at the Rai Bhari. And then there was the intellectual level. And Bachoo was never pretentious, but his formidable intellect came through in his deep curiosity about everything and his eloquence in steering a conversation to its most meaningful level. And then, of course, there was the people level, and this is where Bachoo was really a master. And again, it came out so beautifully when he was in Shantiniketan. And it, when Bachoo was around, it was like there was this buzz that people picked up, and they just came to the Raibari. And again, these wonderful evenings of music, wonderful conversation, laughter, good food. Something very special. As one of my Shantiniketan friends said, you know, Bachoo was one of the few individuals who could bring everything together, different levels. And as Jerry mentioned, of course, he was so good to those of us who came from the outside. And he opened so many doors for me in my Tagore studies. And I think at the very base of all this, lay a deep faith of Bachoo's in the interconnectivity of everything. And I think it was this, he tried to manifest that vision in his life by bringing all these different elements together. And like at Shantiniketan, he could, you know, he was brought the administration, the teachers, the ashramites, everyone came together somehow in this Raibari circle, which was a very beautiful thing. And I would like to close by reading a poem that Bachoo translated. It's a song, a Tagore song. It was sung at my husband's memorial service in Dhaka, and I asked Bachoo to translate it, so I'll read it today. It's Jakun Porbe Namor Payer Chino. When I no longer leave my footprints on the path, nor ply my ferry boat to the landing ghat, there will be an end to buying and selling. I will have settled all my claims, what is due and what is owed. I will move along the village path no more. Won't you forget me then? Won't you then stop calling me, looking at the stars? When the strings of my sitar get covered with dust, and the garden flower in the tall grass buries itself in the woods, when the moss begins to adorn the pond, perhaps then you may no longer remember me, nor call me looking at the stars. Then the flute will go on playing as it did at the site, passing the days. The ferry boat will get filled at the landing ghat on that day. Cows will graze, cowherds will play. And won't you stop calling me then? Perhaps not while looking at the stars. Who will say that I'm not around nor present on that morning, playing always? Won't you then call me by a new name? And I'll be coming and going for you to hold me in your arms, but I'll be coming and going eternally as I am. You may not remember me, nor even call me then, looking at the stars. So happy birthday, Bachoo. We'll miss you.
Thank you, Dr. O'Connell. I now invite our community, one of our community leaders in the Washington, Baltimore metropolitan area, Mr. Asok Motayed. He is the chairperson, president, and CEO of Next Gen Systems Corporation. He also led and chaired the committee of North American Bengali Conference twice held in Maryland, which Honorable Congressman was referring to that he spoke to one of those sessions. And as a leader of the community here, but Asok has worked very intimately with Bachuda on various projects and programs and has known him since, I believe, mid-70s when he moved to the United States. Mr. Asok Motayed, please.
light has gone out, and all we have left is the precious memory of how brightly it burned and the warmth it gave us. I knew Bachuda for a long time, but came to know him very closely while working on this huge conference that we generally hold of Bengalis in North America. And we were organizing it in Baltimore. About 7,000 Bengalis from all over several continents came and attended that. And we, the committee, just couldn't think of anyone representing us at that conference other than our Bachuda. And we approached him, and like he did twice previously and once later after that, he enthusiastically came forward, gave us suggestions, ideas, thoughts, directions, instructions, became truly our advisor and guide, certainly for me. And those of us here who had the chance to be there, we all remember the beautiful speech he gave and how he enthralled the 7,000 Bengalis present there. He loved that idea of people getting together, people thinking along the same lines, people doing things collectively. He had this signal ability to not only make us feel connect with him, but even connect with each other. And that is something, along with the inspiration and the encouraging talks that we had, we all will miss. Bachuda's sense of humor, I guess anyone who has come in touch with him is familiar with that. His good-natured banter, his stories, anecdotes, enlivened any party, and he became quickly the center of any party that he was in. He had this ability to make friends of whoever he met, irrespective of that individual's position in life or society. And he could mix easily at any level and create a bond with the individual at that level. We have already heard and will hear from others how much Bachuda meant to so many. He was a loving husband and father, trusted friend, affectionate elder brother. Certainly that's how I think of him, a friend who is an affectionate elder brother, or elder brother who is a very close, trusting friend. He was a student of politics and current affairs. He was a teacher. He was a proponent of Bengali culture and art. To me, he seemed like a universal man, a Renaissance man. Someone, an epitome of what was best in a bygone era, in a person, in a Bengali. He was dignity, culture, intellect, personified. And when we today celebrate, while we mourn with Jhumu and Broto and their families, extended families, the community, we share the pain and sorrow of the loss. But hidden in that is this reason for celebration of his life. And I celebrate that we were so fortunate to have known him, to have had him in our lives. There is a saying, somebody say that the idea is, said about dying, that the idea is to die young as late as possible. We feel sorry and pain that Bachuda couldn't live any longer, couldn't die later, but he suddenly died young. He gave us his time. He gave us encouragement. He gave us laughter. The time is no more, but the laughter and encouragement will remain. Thank you.
To pick up on that laughter, the spirit, Bachuda, the sense of humor, the joy in his, you know, he brought everything together wherever he is, he was, and we all enjoyed it. And one incident comes to mind. It was only this past, a week ago, Saturday, when I visited him in the hospital. He was mostly sleeping. In the evening when I went, Jumu had just left for dinner, and our good friend Shomen Bashu, Shurmila, his wife Shurmila were there, and so was Atunu Dattu, another common friend. And Bachuda was mostly sleeping, but intermittently would wake up briefly and would recognize our presence. Shomen tried to crack a joke, and we saw, all of us, his face immediately lit up. There was the twinkle in his eyes, and along came very familiar smile. That was the spirit he carried to the end. That was Bachuda. Well, our next speaker is Mary Cliff. We all know Mary Cliff from our long-running radio broadcast traditions, which ran on WETA radio from 1970 to 2007, 37 years. And traditions now airs on WAMU. Right? And at night, 9 o'clock, from 9 o'clock onwards. Mary has been a promoter of, curator and promoter of folk music in Washington area. And it was Mary who provoked Bachuda to bring in the rural traditional form of folk music from Bengal, who introduced in the United States. Mary Cliff, please.
Thank you. It's a privilege to be here. I know Bachu was here because he found me a parking place. right there. In early 1978, I think it was, I was still hosting the international music program Charter Flight on WETA radio. World music wasn't a term we used yet. I also hosted the folk music show that is still traditions. Bachu showed up one afternoon at WETA. He had heard about the folk music show, and he was all set to try to convince me I should play music by the mystic minstrels or bowls living in rural West Bengal and Bangladesh. They were and are, after all, akin to troubadours the world over, unconventional poets who sing their tales, their philosophy, their search for the divine. Essentially an oral culture, their work has influenced India's great poets. Okay, I would have known nothing of this in 1978, except for my friendship with one Jonathan Eberhardt, who, besides being a noted science writer who frequented Jet Propulsion Laboratory, had an insatiable thirst for musics of the world. He made sure I had the LPs of the None Such Explorer series, which included the recording Bowls of Bengal. Bachu was somewhat taken aback when I told him I had heard of this group of performers. I still have a mental picture of standing in Studio 3 at the old station, talking folk music with this man who obviously knew a great deal about it. But as I told him, most of us around the DC area had never seen such performers or the folk instruments they played or heard them live. All we ever heard was the classical music of India. But the Folklore Society of Greater Washington, by the way, celebrating 50 years in 2014, had begun the Washington Folk Festival the previous year, and the second was planned. and Bachoo should contact them and bring this music to the area. He was skeptical. Would they really include it? Jonathan would love it, I told him. So too would another festival founder, Mia Gardner. We exchanged their numbers. The rest is history, I guess. Jonathan was thrilled to meet Bachoo and very soon to hear him perform. Mia strongly urged him to put together a group, his family certainly, to play the music. And so in June 1978, the second Washington Folk Festival in Glen Echo Park, Maryland, Ganga, performed, including Bachoo and wife Lily, daughter Jumo, son Broto, Sanjay Mishra, a couple of folks, I think, from the Voice of America, if I recall correctly, their first performance as a group. They appeared for 20 consecutive years and more. Their 1996 performance at the Washington Folk Festival was dedicated in memory of Lily. Since then, Ganga has performed at festivals around the world, around the US, at the Library of Congress, Four Hours, and other folk societies, and released a couple of CDs. We knew not to ask for a Ganga performance during festival season in India because Bachoo went back every year to the villages. He collected, he studied, he translated, he taught, and he shared it with us. He didn't just play and sing the songs, he put them in context so that we would understand this place, their place in the culture, his beloved culture. He was a true folklorist, and he did finish his book. He was also a true gentleman, a pleasure to work with. Festival people told me to stress that gentleman part and his ease to work with. Bachoo was, after all, our favorite dotara player. Mia Gardner would have been here if she weren't out of the country, so on behalf of the staff of the Washington Folk Festival, the Folklore Society of Greater Washington, and all of us who have enjoyed his music, we thank Bachoo Roy for his unique and irreplaceable contributions and for his friendship and that of his family.
Thank you, Mary. The Ganga CDs that she was referring to, they are available here. We would like you to pick up a copy as a memorabilia. And I guess we have about 10 more minutes time, so this is kind of an open forum. If anybody wants to come up or just raise yourself and speak about Bachuda. Sure.
Bachuda was the heart of our community, binding us together with his love. He always had a kind word for anybody who needed his support. He was a friend to all, talented people and celebrities, as well as ordinary people like me with no special talent. The first time you met him, he made you feel so comfortable and spoke to you with such familiarity that you felt that you had known him all your life. He charmed the ladies, an easy task for a man with his talents, but he also accomplished the far more difficult task of charming the gentlemen without some of them even realizing that they had been charmed. He grew on you. If you spent time with him, you came to love him. You have to travel a great distance to come across a rare person like Bachuda. Those of us who made the journey to this distant land are glad we did so, because of the wonderful experience of coming to know Bachuda. Some of you here have told me that you knew him for many more years than some of us less fortunate souls did, and we missed out on all the fun of enjoying his company for so many years. And when you said that, I heard the pride in your voice and felt the love in your heart. And both those emotions are totally justified. It is indeed a great joy to have known Bachuda for most of your life. He never lost his youthful spirit and his love for life and people. He showed us the way life is meant to be lived and death is meant to be laughed at. We cannot hope to emulate him, but we will try not to disappoint him too much. In spite of his many talents, Bachuda was a totally unassuming and very humble person. He would be embarrassed to hear the accolades being showered on him without the opportunity to respond with his characteristic wit. He would find a way to quietly sneak out of the room. So I will not embarrass him any further. Let me just say in parting, farewell, dear friend. And if forever, then forever, farewell. All of us will join you at some time. And when we do, we will share with you the emptiness you left in our lives. And we will catch up with what you have been up to up there. We will sit around and chat, talking about nothing in particular, just passing the time before time passes us by, like you love to do. I will look forward to it when my time comes.
Thank you. Bachuda, Bodhi, and everyone. I have known Bachuda for almost 50 years of my life. It's a great reunion for me to see where I walked in and saw Jerry yesterday. Of course, I have seen Kathy. Say, Mike, I didn't meet you there, but I know of you through Raka. So when they were talking about the things about the Sing Song group, about the work camps that we all went, of course, they talk from the perspective of a foreigner who went to another country and was made home. And the opportunity Bachoo and Bodhi gave us to get to know the people from another part and get to know them and taught us how to be hospitable to everybody. I have been in a lot of courses where I had to learn about multiculturalism or to learn how to become a global person. But my education started long times ago in the Essenbanity home of the lives, which was the best multicultural education ground anyone can have. I'm not only happy for Bachuda's life, as you celebrated it, I'm also happy that Bachuda has gone home to be with Bodhi, and they are going to be celebrating. I am going to read a poem that I think is very appropriate from Gitanjali, and I think Bachuda would have appreciated. At the time of my parting, wish me good luck, my friends. The sky is flushed with the dawn, and my path lies beautiful. Ask not what I have with me to take there. I start on my journey with empty hands and expectant heart. I shall put on my wedding garland. Mine is not the red-brown dress of the traveler. And though there are dangers on the way, I have no fear in mind. The evening star will come out when my voyage is done, and the plaintive notes of twilight melodies to stack up from the king's gateway. And I'm sure you all know that. Amar jabar belate tora joyottho nikar. And I think, on behalf of all the friends, we can say joy jatra jayo.
Bachuda uplifted us all, I think anybody ever met. I'd like to read a poem from Tagore. I don't have the English translation, but it's about, it's not death, it's not destruction, it's just an end. And it's a tribute to the E Mahasundara Shesh, it's the greatly beautiful end. I pay my tribute to you. That's the essence of the poem. Bidai, farewell. Khama karo, dhurcha dharo, hok sundar taro, bidaer kham. Mrittunai, dhangshunai, nahe bichheder bhai, shudhu shamapon. Shudhu shukho hote sriti, shudhu beta hote giti, tori hote tir, khela hote, khela shanti, basuna hoite shanti, nabho hote nir. Dinanter namro kar, poduk mathar par, akhi pare ghum, ridayer patro pute, govane utuk pute, nishar kusum. Arotir shankhrabe, namiya ashuk tabe, purno purinam. Hashi noy, osru noy, udar bairagmay, vishal visram. Prabhate je pakshi shobe, gechilo kolorabe, thamuk ekhon. Prabhate je fulguli, jegechilo muktuli, mriduk noyon. Prabhate je bayudol, firechilo sachanchal, jak theme jak. Nirabe udaye hok, asim nakkhatra lok, parom nirvak. He mahasundar shesh, he bidaye animesh, he sommo bishad, khanek darao sthir.
Muchay nayanunir karo ashirvad Khanik darao sthir Padotale namishir Tabo jatra pathe Nishkamp pradib dhari Nishabde arati kari Nistabdha jagate
Good things come to an end. This wonderful memorial service is coming to a close. And a couple of announcements. The family has arranged a reception downstairs, and the CDs with Bachuda's voice are there on the table next to the door up front on my right. And we would like to end this wonderful memorial service for our beloved Bachuda, Universal Bachuda, with his own voice. Let's hear him.
Thank you.
behalf of Krishna, her husband, George, Broto, and his wife, Teresa, I thank you all for joining this memorial service.